Hello everyone. So first of all, thank you for the organizers to give me the opportunity to present my work here today. This is a work in progress that I'm doing together with Francisco Prada, my PhD supervisor. I'm now a postdoc, but he's my old supervisor. We're doing a work on dark matter, cold matter halo concentrations, and the implications of these concentration models on in the computation of the dark matter annihilation superstructure boosts. So I realized that this talk is a little bit off topic in this workshop, but this is just a natural consequence of my own expertise. I'm working in gamma ray dark matter searches with the Fermi satellite, but still I thought that it could be a very good idea to come here today, to especially to get some feedback from you guys that are the real experts on all this stuff. So let me move on a little bit. I would like to start with this kind of nice figures that you probably, well, I guess that you are very familiar with. In particular, this picture is coming from the G-Halo simulation, a Milky Way size halo simulation performed by Joachim Stadel and collaborators in 2009. So just to put a little bit this in more, in the right context, we now believe that the visible part of the galaxies, galaxies like our own, are just a small fraction of the total matter in the whole system, let's say. And this visible galaxy is actually, this visible part is actually surrounded by a smooth distribution of dark matter that extends very, very far indeed up to the virial, characteristic of virial radius of the object. But we actually know that this is, so we don't have only this smooth component of dark matter, we also have, as you know, we have this kind of clumps inside host halos. This is a clear prediction of lambda CDM, how the structure formation actually occurs. And you expect a lot of sub-halos be hosted by larger halos, like in the case of the Milky Way, right? So it is believed that the most massive sub-halos host the dwarf galaxy satellites of the Milky Way, while there is still a huge population of these guys, with the smaller masses that have not been detected yet, probably because many of them actually host just a few stars, or maybe no, they don't host stars or gas at all, and they can be completely dark, no optical counterpart at all. So I guess that at this point it's clear, that matter superstructure can be actually very relevant for the matter searches. On one hand, because both dwarf satellites and these dark satellites, let's say, can be excellent targets. Some of them are actually very high dark matter dominated systems. So given the distances and masses of some of them, they could be actually very relevant, good targets for us. And on the other hand, of course, this clumpy distribution of subhalos inside larger halos may boost the dark matter annihilation signal that we expect in our gamma ray telescopes. So in this talk, I will focus on this second possibility, this so-called superstructure boosts. We are now working also inside the Fermi collaboration in the first topic, but again, I won't talk about it today. I will focus on the second possibility. So just a reminder for those of you that are not familiar with all this, the dark matter annihilation gamma ray flash that you expect in your telescope above a particular energy threshold is given by the product of two terms. One that we call it's known as J factor, and it's essentially the integral along the line of sight of the square of the dark matter density. Okay. For the purpose of this talk, note that this dark matter density is actually you have to include not only the smooth distribution of the matter, the smooth dark matter density profile, but also this subclamps, this superstructure, right? And on the other hand, you have also a second factor, which we call the particle physics factor, that encloses all the particle physics considerations. And I'm not going to talk about it, just mentioning that it's proportional to the cross-section of the annihilation. Then it's inversely proportional to the square of the mass of the dark matter particle that you consider. And also, you have to take into account, you have to compute the number of photons that you expect per annihilation for a given channel, annihilation channel. There are different channels, different possibilities. But again, I'm not going to talk about this in my talk. So I will focus on this part, of course. So yes, I would like to mention also that this J factor, of course, since it's related to the dark matter density profile that you consider, can be also expressed in terms of you know, the usual, the standard, you know, the standard parameters for damage density profiles, not only like the scale radius or scale densities, also concentration mass or Vmax, Rmax, this kind of pair of parameters that, you know, give you the damage density profile. So let me focus on the superstructure, the boost coming from this superstructure, and how we compute that. As I said, you expect some kind of annihilation enhancement in your annihilation signal due to these guys, because it goes as the square of the damage density, this annihilation signal, right? So when you have a lot of subhalos, a lot of clamps that are very concentrated inside larger halos, you expect some kind of enhancement due to these guys, no? To these subhalos. So I will define here the superstructure boost factor as equal zero if it is not if there is no boost, and then equal for instance equal to one means that you are double you have double the luminosity of the host halo due to the presence of these subhalos, right? So this is expression that we are using to compute the boost factors. It's essentially an integral of the subhalo mass function, which is given here, times the luminosity of every subhalo, of course. And then this accounts for other levels of enhancements due to superstructure. No? So there are different levels of superstructure, and you can also include there these guys. So by the way, you have to integrate this whole expression between a minimum mass, which is the minimum halo mass predicted by theoretical by some theoretical models. Essentially, it has to do with the kinetic with the temperature that with the kinetic decoupling temperature in the universe between the matter particles and the ordinary matter, and then you have to integrate all this between this, the minimum halo mass, up to the mass of the host that you are considering, and all that divided by the host halo luminosity, because this this is relative, right? According to this definition here, so it's very clear that it's obvious that this boost factor depends essentially on the internal structure that you consider for these subhalos, which gives you the luminosity. And of course, this subhalo mass function is telling you about abundance, no? How many subhalos you have per mass decay. Okay, so of course, n-body simulations can help on this. So we go to n-body simulations to do all this stuff. But then, of course, I told you that the minimum halo mass can be as low as 10 to the minus 6 solar masses or so. This can depend a lot, depending on, you know, the details of the computations. You can find papers that tells you something like 10 to the minus 3 or even higher, but down to 10 to the minus 12 solar masses or so. So I think that this 10 to the minus 6 solar masses can be a good value for just to keep in mind. But we know that the simulations, you know, the state of the art simulations of Milky Way size halos, for instance, don't go, you know, that far. So the mass resolution is essentially like 10 to the 5 solar masses or so for Via Láctea or Aquarius, for instance. So it's clear that we have to do some kind of extrapolations below the mass resolution. Okay, thank you. So for the subhalo mass function, we don't have major problems, let's say. So it's, we model the subhalo mass function in the usual form, with alpha being the slope of the subhalo mass function. The Aquarius guys are talking about something like 1.9, while Via Láctea 2 still, well, at least in the most you know, in the old papers, they were talking about minus 2 or so. So we will use actually these two numbers in our computations. As for the subhalo annihilation luminosity, this J factor I was talking about before, is it turns out that it's proportional to the third power of the concentration over this kind of function that depends on the concentration. This is the standard function f of c for n of w, right? And then you immediately realize that it actually depends a lot how you extrapolate the concentration all the way down to the minimum halo mass. You can get actually very different results for the boosts. So it's very sensitive to how you extrapolate the things, right? Okay, so what can we do regarding the smallest halos that we don't have actually direct information from simulations? So people have taken two approaches so far. So one is just assume a simplistic power law extrapolation all the way down to the minimum halo mass, okay? And then there's a second approach that other people took. It's just to try to motivate this kind of extrapolation physically, taking into account the, you know, how the structure form and evolve in the universe, and how the concentration indeed evolves, you know, with time, right? As I said, this depending on how you extrapolate the things, you will get different, very different answers indeed. Okay, so what about lambda CDM? I mean, what does it tell you about this? So the point probably is a little bit more complicated than this. I was talking with Anatoly about it, but I think this is probably summarizes the main point here. So as all of you know, natural concentrations are set by the essentially by the formation time of the halo. Okay, so given the power spectrum that you have, given the RMS of this power spectrum, the shape of this RMS and the power spectrum, it turns out that in lambda CDN the smallest halos collapse nearly more or less at the same time in the early universe. So over a huge range of masses. Okay, at the smallest scales, no. So this means that since the concentration is natural concentration is given by the formation time, and all of them collapse nearly at the same time, all of them will have nearly more or less the same kind of concentration values, and this means a flattening in the concentration mass relation at the smallest scales. So these power loss extrapolations are not in principle expected in lambda CDM. So that's the main point. So this is this plot. In this plot, I try to summarize was the current knowledge of the concentration mass relation for all halo masses. I try to collect all the data from the simulations at all the scales, as I said. So of course, as you know, above 10 to the 10 or so, the results are very very abundant. We know a lot about how the concentration mass relation at this scale. But I just plot here, I just use here the results from multi-dark and Bolzoi simulations that use WMAP 5 and 7 cosmological parameters. Then I also did some work to get these data points. The black points correspond come from some data from some work by Pedro Colin in 2004. And these points here are some halos that were individual halos, by the way, that we rescued from Via Láctea 2 beyond the visual radius of Via Láctea. And at the lowest mass end, I'm just plotting here, just using the concentration values found by Jules Diemann in 2005, and more recently by Ander Handen at Diemann in 2013, this year. So they are also giving very nice concentration values at the lowest mass end. So regarding the models, here I'm plotting in the black solid line correspond to the Prada et al. Concentration model in 2012. So I will refer to this concentration model as P12 from now on. Okay, and as you can see, even when this concentration model was essentially done, thank you. Wow, very fast. So. So even when the model was essentially performed to account for concentrations in this region, you can see that extrapolation of the model to the lowest masses actually agree very well with the scarce simulation data that we have there, and this actually has we can understand that perfectly. So I would like to make the point that we have a little knowledge of what happens in all these, at smallest scales, and I hope this can motivate actually some further work to understand how is actually the concentration mass relation in simulations, right? So it would be nice to have more details. Just very briefly again, you can see that these power loss extrapolations seem to be ruled out both by the data that we have and also by the physically motivated models that link the concentration with the RMS of the power spectrum, like the P12 model indeed. So this is another way to plot it. This is what we call the U-shaped plot. Here I'm just plotting the concentration versus the inverse of the RMS of the power spectrum of the sigma, okay, and the same data points. So as you can see, actually, by the way, dashed line correspond to the region in this parameter space where the P12 model was not tested, okay. So as you can see, all data points actually but only the Via Láctea 2 guys are in the region of the parameter space where the P12 model was for which the model was proposed. Okay, so indeed we are not doing this kind of strong extrapolations to small halo masses. And then I come to my results for the superstructure boost. This was actually what motivated the whole work, at least for me. So you can see here in this left plot what happens when you vary the minimum halo mass. 10 to the minus, I don't know if you see correctly, 10 to the minus 6, and this is the slope of the Suhelo mass function. So 10 to the minus 6, 1.9, okay, this guy, 10 to the minus 12, 1.9, 10 to the minus 6, alpha 2, and 10 to the minus 12 alpha 2. So this is what we consider like our fiducial model, let's say. And then here we compare this fiducial model, the same black solid line, okay, with other calculations of superstructure boosts that were performed before. Dashed line to for a model that that Macalobertos and me also presented in 2011, using a completely different approach. And then the dotted line corresponds to one of an example of this an example of superstructure boost that you find when you assume power loss extrapolations all the way down to the minimum halo mass. So while they are finding, for instance, for cluster size halos, they are finding something like 1,000 superstructure boost factors. We are finding something like 30 or 40 or something like that. And I think this is my summary. Okay, so superstructure, a key ingredient in planning future gamma research strategies for several reasons: excellent targets, and also you expect an enhancement of your radiation signal due to the sub-halos. Then, regarding superstructure boost factors, they are of course very sensitive to how you extrapolate things. We find that they are especially relevant for clusters, of course, but we find moderate values of order 50 or so, and probably order 10 or so for Milky Way size halos. And regarding halo concentrations, P12 is a good concentration model that works in principle very well with all the data that we have at different halo masses. And again, the last point, the power loss extrapolations are clearly ruled out in principle by data and models, physically motivated models. Thank you.